Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 14th meeting of 2016 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. We have apologies from Finlay Carson. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones and electronic devices as they may affect the broadcasting system. Agenda item one concerns taking items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are the committee agreed? We are agreed. So we move to agenda item two, which is Scottish Water's annual report 2015-16. We have a panel of witnesses. Can I introduce them? There's Lady Susan Rice, Chair of Scottish Water, Joanna Dow, Chief Executive of Business Stream, Douglas Milliken, the Chief Executive of Scottish Water, and Peter Farrar, Chief Operating Officer of Scottish Water. We will move immediately to questions. Welcome all of you. Dave Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. And it's nice to speak to you all again. And the previous committee, I think you reported to ICI committee, and we had a number of questions at that stage. Can I ask perhaps just some of a bigger picture question? First is trying to get an understanding of how you make difficult decisions between setting charges at the right level and having sufficient investment to invest in the business in the longer term. These are very difficult questions, but I think the committee would be find it very useful if we could have some understanding of that.
It's a very important question as well, and I will ask Douglas to give you the detail, but I can assure you that this is an iterative and deep a process of deep thinking that goes into those decisions. Douglas, you can...
Okay, thank you. The way that it works is effectively over a fairly medium to long-term planning cycle. We used to operate in five-year planning cycles, and we're now in a six-year planning cycle. And effectively, if I start at the end and then I'll work back, at the end of the process, ahead of the start of any new regulatory period, the Scottish Government effectively issue a direction to us of the improvements we have to make in the upcoming 6 years and the principles to be applied in the way that charges are levied on customers, all in the context of a regulatory settlement or final determination provided by our economic regulator, the Water Industry Commission. So that's at the end of the process. If then work back to the start, clearly many inputs into that. The inputs into that are things like, you know, what are customer views of their priorities in terms of existing service, in terms of improvements to services, what are customer views on charge levels, and the extent to which they are willing and choose to pay more or less for different levels of service. There's then the whole dynamic of what do we need to spend to invest just to maintain the existing infrastructure to deliver the broadly comparable level of service today into the future. There are then issues to be considered from a kind of a legal compliance angle around what do we need to do primarily from investment angle to comply with drinking water legislative requirements or environmental compliance issues. And then the final aspect is the role that we play in supporting economic growth and extending the infrastructure to cope with new housing and additional business demands. So those are all those inputs go in over really a 2 or 3 year period. And then kind of, as Susan said, it kind of iterates between ourselves with customer groups, with the economic regulator and with ministers. And then it ultimately lands in that settlement that's set. So for the time period we're in now, we're in a six-year period that started in April 2015 and runs to March 21, where those priorities were really all confirmed at the end of 2014.
Thank you. That's a very comprehensive answer. Could I ask then another wider question? I mean, does the current model that you have, which is effectively you're a public body answerable to Scottish Government, work well for you as chief officers and board members? I mean, obviously, looking across the UK, there's different models. I'm not recommending them. I'm really saying, obviously, in England, there is a private model. And if I could refer members to my interests as a member of the Co-op Party would argue that mutualisation is another model. Is that something that you've had any discussions with senior ministers about in terms of a different way of operating, different way of running?
If I could just give a general view to answer your question, you could speak to any specific conversations with ministers. I think that the track record of Scottish Water speaks for itself when you compare its customer service ratings, when you compare it, the effectiveness and productivity and its use of its investment funds, comparing to the other companies in the UK. I mean, it is absolutely outstanding. It wasn't always there, but it has worked and it has achieved that, which suggests that the current model has great merit. I would say, and I can say this because I'm not an executive in the company, I chair the board, that delivering it in that way depends on the right people in the executive roles. And that is always the case in any business, in fact. I'd also point out that where you have water companies, utilities, which in particular are owned by investors who are looking for shorter term returns, that can put a pressure on a business which has to be long term, which has to look to the future. Its infrastructure projects take a long time to build. We have to look 25, 50 years ahead to make sure that we understand what Scotland might be like in the future and that we can deliver safe and adequate water and wastewater services. So there's something positive about the ability with this structure to take that long-term view. So far, it's worked well. In terms of alternate structures, Douglas, you could speak to that.
I don't, there's been no discussion with ministers at all on alternatives. And I think I would just really echo Lady Rice's comments from an executive angle, that I think the model that we have, where effectively there's a strong alignment between the interests of the Scottish Government as the owner of Scottish Water with the interests of our customers, means that effectively everything that we do is orientated to delivering our customers. So, for example, when we're engaging our people to drive for ever higher performance, the whole rationale is, whether it's higher service or greater efficiency, those benefits are all going back to our customers and to our communities. So I think from our perspective, the model works extremely well. Having said that, you know, as every day and every year goes by, we always look at how we can enhance the way in which we operate to deliver ever higher service and become ever more efficient.
Can I go from the bigger picture to very specific? Could you give the committee some indication of what will happen to domestic charges after 2018?
Right, so if I just put that into a little bit of context, so in answer to the earlier question, I talked about the ministerial principles of charging that were set for this six-year period in the context of the regulatory determination. So what that determination means is that across the 6 years, the prices to customers will fall relative to the rate of inflation, and they'll fall by 1.8% relative to inflation. Because of where the price changes have happened over the last 2 years and indeed for next year, what that means is in 2018 to 21, on average, prices per year will fall by 1.5% relative to the rate of inflation. So to some extent, it'll depend precisely where inflation's at, but we're looking at continuing very modest levels of price change. And even that, again, was rooted in the work that we did in agreeing our business plan with the Customer Forum, where one of the key things that came out from our customer research was customers valuing predictability and stability in prices, and to make sure that we weren't suddenly lurching to sudden price changes from 1 year to the next.
Yeah, and just for a technical point, the level of inflation you're monitoring is the CPI,
consumer
price index, because there's a bit of a debate to be had about which measure you have of inflation for a variety of areas. But I won't go down the pedantic line, I just may want to put
so
that
just to be, just to be very clear for the record, in terms of the commitment to customers, then customer price increases are rooted relative to CPI.
And my final point, convener, is some of my colleagues will look at much more detail about your overall performance for 2015-16, but the sort of general scorecard is very good, looking at the various indications on every indicator bar one. Could I raise one point about customer service, which you may know I've raised in the past, and that relates to whole issues such as climate change, which is about water leakage. I think the 3 years ago, I think the figure was roughly a third of all your water was lost in leakage. Now that may well have changed. The current figure is your target is 500 million litres a day, which is very hard to get that figure in terms of understanding what that means. But just before I came out, I sort of looked it up, and just to make it easier to understand, for me particularly, that means 100 Commonwealth pools every day is lost in terms of water leakage. Now, obviously, that's got huge implications for climate change, because clearly you're providing energy for that third that's now been lost. First of all, the target seems to be extremely high. Now, I do acknowledge there's been an improvement over the last 3 years, and it's not a third of your water anymore. But could you, first of all, say why that target is so high? I mean, 500 million litres a day is a phenomenal amount of water.
Let me just do a bit of context and then let Peter pick up specifically what we do around leakage management. The target that we have for this regulatory period, that 500, is all based off the economics. And actually sitting behind that, and it's quite a high number, is a really good news story. And it's a good news story rooted in history, that Scotland is blessed with having a lot of gravity-fed water supplies. And that therefore means relative to other parts of the UK, we consume far less energy in taking water from source to customers' taps. And that really is at the heart of what drives you, what is the effectively is the economic level of leakage. And the second thing I'll just say in overview, we take leakage really seriously. And that's why last year we actually achieved our target for the end of this regulatory period. So our target for effectively 2020, we achieved in our very first year. And while there still are the winter months to go of this year, sitting where we're at the moment, we're in a better position at this time this year than we were at this time last year. So we're absolutely continuing to bear down on leakage.
Okay, so Douglas mentioned that we're working to what we call the economic level of leakage, which is effectively the point where the cost of reducing the leakage becomes greater than the savings from energy and chemicals of producing the water in the first place. So that's the primary objective. However, what we do, and as technology changes, we're continually developing new and more efficient means of fixing leaks. So as that develops and as technology develops, the economic cost of the leakage comes down as well. So that will drive further leakage reductions just through progression in the industry. I think one of the key measures, and we've been focusing on leakage for a number of years now, and we've been extremely successful with that. So over the period from when we started this, we've reduced our leakage by about 500 million litres per day. Now, that's the equivalent of the amount of water that goes in to supply the whole of Edinburgh four times. And we've reduced that since we started in 2006. So the big benefits of that, apart from reducing energy use and chemical production, it's also providing a headroom at our treatment works for growth. So by reducing that leakage, we can now extend the stretch of the water that we've got to provide growth for businesses and for household customers, where before, if we hadn't reduced that leakage, we would have had to build new investment to provide that.
I mean, clearly, I'm sure all the committee would welcome these improvements. The point I make is that's still a horrendous amount of water to be losing. And in the 2013 figure, it was one-third of all the water. I think you had 1.3 billion litres was your total production in that period. I'm not sure what the current proportion is, but it's probably just about equivalent. But you take my point, you know, 100 Commonwealth pools per day in loss is an issue for climate change. And what would you see your aspirations for 3 or 4 years' time?
I mean, I think, as Peter said, this is something. It's a dynamic calculation, and it's kept under review. And I think the main issue from a climate change angle is in Scotland, and the issues can be different in Scotland to other places. But in a Scottish context, the principal issue is the energy and chemicals that get consumed in treating water and to the extent the water needs to be pumped. So there's a huge amount of work that we've done to drive efficiency into the use of energy, to reduce the amount that we consume. And we've done a huge amount to increase the amount of energy that we generate ourselves. So for example, by the end of this year, by March next year, through our own renewable generation, either what we do directly or what we enable in our land, we will be supporting as much renewable generation as we consume ourselves. If I then roll that on into 2018-2019, we expect to be effectively generating or supporting generation that's equivalent to double the amount of electricity that we consume ourselves. So I think in that whole kind of area of carbon reduction, there's a whole bunch of things that we do, but it's a very, very important topic.
Thank you, Convener.
Just for the purposes of clarity, for the record, the figures, the improvements that we're talking about, relate to the public water supply, is that right? What I'm getting at is, do they take account of leakages on private supplies or when the supply is taking place on farmland?
Yes, it does. It's the leakage that we measure is everything that's lost from the system, from the treatment works to the point of use with customers.
Okay, right, thank you. Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I should declare for the record, Convener, that I have a family member in the Western Isles who's currently in dispute with Scottish Water through the Court of Session over the alleged poisoning of livestock. And we may turn to the issue of spills on farmland later. However, for the moment, I'd like to continue looking at investment, which has been touched on earlier. The Convener and I were pleased to visit and see at first hand the progress at the Shieldhall Tunnel in Glasgow a few months ago, and an impressive feat of engineering it was. Given the number of investments that you're making in 2015-16, and given the diverse and sometimes competing ministerial objectives, how does Scottish Water prioritise your investment decisions?
I think at the highest level, I refer back really to the first answer that I gave, which is that there's a huge amount of work done over many years through what's called the quality and standards process, which is a ministerial-led process to look at what all the different potential demands are from a customer service improvement, from an asset maintenance angle, from drinking water quality and environmental protection. Those are all assessed, and then ultimately, having gone through due process, it is ministers who then decide that when looking at those issues relative to issues in terms of availability of borrowing and where customer charges should be, they then effectively determine the overall objectives that we need to achieve in a period. Sitting then underneath that are details of all then the individual your projects to deliver or outputs that we need to achieve. So an output might be improved drinking water quality to a particular community, or it might be an upgrade to a wastewater treatment system. But effectively, the root of the prioritisation is all that ministerial-led quality and standards process.
Okay, thanks. Now, we know of the Shieldhall project that we mentioned already, but where in Scotland has the most investment taken place during the year, and on what projects?
I think one of the really strong features about the whole model, the whole Scottish Water model, I don't just mean Scottish Water, but the industry model that sits behind that, and the process of setting ministerial objectives, is at the heart of that is the ambition that every customer in Scotland, irrespective of wherever they are, should achieve the same level of service for the same price that they pay. And what that means, when I look at that back over the passage of history, what that means is in different investment periods, some communities have a significantly more investment than others. So I could look back into prior periods, and we had a huge amount of investment in the Highlands and Islands, for example. In this particular period, the single biggest area that's getting investment is Glasgow. And the genesis of that was work that's been done to look at all the environmental upgrades in Glasgow, partly to comply with the various legal requirements for improvements to discharges to the Clyde and its tributaries, but also to deal with the challenges of flooding from sewers. And that's been a programme of work that's been long in the making to study hard the interdependencies of flows in our sewers with other surface water flows in the Glasgow area. And that's now leading effectively in this period to about £250 million investment in Glasgow. But I could look at over probably a 10-year period, and we will be investing probably about £500 million in environmental improvements in Glasgow. So that is the largest at the moment, but it does vary from period to period.
Okay, thanks. And the investment in renewables that you mentioned earlier, how long will it take to get a return on that investment?
So there are different forms of investment that we have. In terms of our things that we do directly, we've got a lot of hydro turbines in water pipes. We have wind, small-scale wind that we have. We have large-scale wind where we effectively invite private developers onto our land to develop large-scale wind schemes. We've got photovoltaics. We've got energy being generated from food waste. We've now even got schemes where we're taking heat from our sewers to effectively provide the energy from a local college. So it's a whole bunch of different ways and different commercial models, some of which we're investing directly, and typically in those the return might be in anything from a 4 to 7 year type period. Then there's other models where effectively the commercial developers make an investment and we may be taking the return in the form of either a rental stream or reduced purchase prices for power that we buy.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I just ask, there was a proposal for a very substantial wind project in my constituency at Backwater Reservoir that was shelved. Is that permanently shelved, or is it possibilities of that being resurrected?
From a technical perspective, the proposed developer still has an option that they pay an annual fee to us to keep live. But on the basis that that has not got planning consent, I think that's a long way from ever being developed. So if you were to ask us at the moment, do we think it's likely? No, we don't think it's likely.
Okay, thank you, that's useful. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, convener. And for a begin, I make reference to my register of interest, a number of dealings with Scottish Water from construction, development, fishing, private supplies, troughs, a few others. You mentioned the role of supporting economic growth, and from my previous dealings in the private sector and since being elected, you know, a number of conversations with public bodies such as councils, people in infrastructure, and groups such as Scottish Futures Trust, they all say the biggest impediment to delivering growth and projects is Scottish Water. Particular area is some of the transparency and some of the delivery of these projects, where projects which are talked about as being delivered in the next 2 years are listed but not scheduled, which doesn't give clarity to people coming in to behind that to deliver projects. I'm just wondering, how would you respond to that? I see you've decided to enter into 3 new strategic alliances to deliver investment. I believe this process has taken longer than envisaged. Has any investment slipped because of that? And how do you expect to make up some of that ground?
Let me give you a bit of an overview, and I'll talk about our investment programme, then Peter can talk about the work that we do to support the development community. So at an overall level, in terms of our investment programme, our investment programme is absolutely motoring. Last year, I think we delivered about £480 million investment, which was very consistent with the prior years. In the current year, we'll be up at around £600 million. We're consistently delivering around £50 million a month. So the investment programme is absolutely moving right across the country. And we have 3 new alliances that are in place, and they're operating and really successful because they work with a number of contractors. So, for example, we've got 58 contractors that we work with in rural areas, and it's quite an elegant hybrid model. So, for example, one project I visited a few months ago in Stromness in Orkney, very challenging scheme there about upgrading the wastewater infrastructure in the very tight streets of Stromness. But there, our alliance partner, ABV, is working very effectively with a Kirkwall-based contractor to deliver that investment. If I come on to supporting economic growth, that is an absolute priority for us. There are various complexities that sit around that space. Sometimes it can be down to certainty about what developments will progress. Sometimes it can be down to clarity about who pays for what. But we are absolutely committed to supporting it. And if there are any specific cases that you or indeed any other members are aware of that you want to pass away to look at, we will happily look at those. But we've done a huge amount of work to up our game in this space, and I'll let Peter address that.
Okay, thanks. So as Douglas said, we want to make sure that we are not being a barrier to any economic growth and development through our processes. And we have completely remodeled the part of the business that deals with that over the last 12 months in particular. We can impact on that through normal connections to our network. So we're starting to see a significant increase in the number of connection applications that are coming through. And there's absolutely no doubt that the housing market is starting to heat up. We're considerably above our predictions for household connections for this year. We'd predicted in our business plan that there'd be about 16,500, and we're forecasting now that there'll be about 21,500 for this year. So that's an indication of what's happened just over the last 18 months since we set the plan. So we've completely redeveloped the group to look at that, because we did get some feedback from developers that our processes were not the easiest. So we've really taken that seriously and turned that around. In terms of investment on our treatment works to facilitate growth, so over this regulatory period, we're investing about £220 million to support economic development. About £80 million of that is to increase the capacity of our strategic assets. That's our water and wastewater treatment works to provide the new water capacity or the treatment, the wastewater treatment capacity. And there's a further £108 million which contributes to the costs that the developers have of providing what we call Part 2 and Part 3 infrastructure, which are the pipes and the sewers in the ground. So there's a significant amount of investment. In terms of the improvements that we've focused on in the last 12 to 18 months, we're working very closely with Homes for Scotland, and in fact, Susan and the chair of Homes for Scotland have signed a memorandum of understanding, and we're really focused on providing as good a service as we can to that that community. We've picked up on improvements to our customer relationship model to make sure that we have got the right people speaking to developers, particularly the big developers who have significant strategic schemes across the country. And we've also made some significant improvements to make sure that we are facilitating all the big strategic schemes that are on the go at the moment. For example, the A96 corridor, Aberdeen, Shawfair, Perth, Dundee. There's some significant big strategic schemes on the go, and we've changed our model to make sure that we're dealing with that in a much more customer-focused way than we've done before.
Thank you for that, and I welcome the answers and opportunities to come back with individual cases within the constituency. And I should note the Institute of Civil Engineers gives you a B, which I think is a good mark, so that should probably be noted as well in terms of delivery. Do you think the problem's wider than that, in that it goes to the planning process in Scotland of when projects, or whether public sector or private sector, when they become live, so to speak, for you to be able to consider them in your planning? Do you think there's a problem which goes beyond or with your where you can statutory considerations?
I'm not sure that we would define it as a problem. I think there's a reality, and there's lots of complexity, and there are lots of competing priorities maybe between what a local authority might want to achieve, what a developer might want to achieve, and the wishes and preferences of particular communities that might be affected. So for me, it's all about how do we work in it most effectively, in a most integrated way, and in an anticipatory way with local authorities, particularly the various different roles that they play as a planning authority, as a neighbour of growth, as a developer themselves. So from a personal perspective, I try and make sure I have a regular dialogue with the chief executives of all the local authorities as a specific. I was with the chief executive of Stirling Council on Friday, very much in that space, looking at the plans that they have for development in the Stirling area, both through the local authority and the prospective city deal, to make sure that we're totally joined up and that we do all that we can do to support the ambitions and aspirations in that part of the country.
Mark Roscoe. At that point, I should declare an interest as a councillor in Stirling, but I have a question slightly different. I was interested actually just to hear your response to Alexander Burnett about alliances. Does that point towards perhaps more outsourcing of services over time to private contractors? And I think it goes back partly to Dave Stewart's point around mutualisation, because one of the criticisms that's levelled at Welsh Water is that it's effectively a shell company. It ostensibly acts in the public interest and has public stakeholders involved in that company, but at the same time, you know, all those services pretty much are delivered by private contractors. That was one point. The second point was in relation to the Wicks report, which is very positive in all areas. But one area which they did pick up on was around the sort of underperformance of completing projects from previous Q&S investment rounds. I'm just wondering if you've got thoughts on that as to what those reasons are. I'm aware, for example, of one project in Kinghorn. There's quite complex reasons why that project's been delayed and it's going to be pushed forward to a later timescale. But just wondering if there are lessons that can be learned around under-delivery of projects and how you then make sure that future Q&S investment rounds deliver in a timely fashion.
Okay, let me take them in. I'll start with that one, then I'll come on to the outsourcing question. So, I mean, the headline for me, there's always opportunity to learn. As an organisation, we've got to be a learning organisation. There's always things we can learn from things that go well or things that go less well. In terms of investment programme, to put the Commission's comment into a bit of context, I referred in answer to an earlier question about the under the ministerial objectives, then a set of projects, defined projects. And for the last regulatory period, there were 1,080 of those, 1,080 at the start. And at the end of the regulatory period in March 2015, we had 37 left to deliver. And you know, that was slightly more than we expected to have at that time, and that's why the Commission called it out. But what I'm pleased to note is that of those 37 projects in March 15, 27 of them have now been completed. It was 22 at March 16, and we've now taken that up to 27. So it's leaving 10 to go. If I then link that to the next point. So from a learning angle, I think one of the things that we've always had a bit of a mixed economy model. Things that we do in-house and things that get done by delivery partners in the private sector. And we keep that under review as to what should be done by private companies and what should we do internally. And probably the most significant change that we've made coming into this period is we've actually brought back in-house the upfront decision-making and thinking around investment planning. And a lot of that is come out of the learning that we've had from some of the lessons in the last investment period. That is incredibly key to you maximise the value in projects by getting the thinking right, trying to get the right scope, understanding all the ground conditions and so on and so forth before you go to site and start work. And we brought a lot of that work in-house. Beyond that aspect that we've brought in-house, we'll always keep under view where things should get delivered. But I think we've got a pretty stable balance where we recognise that our core competence is very much in customer service, in looking after the whole water supply system, and looking after the wastewater supply system. So looking ahead into the future, probably the most significant question that we'll get into in the next decade is what happens when our various PFI contracts come to an end, because we've got about Nearly half our wastewater treatment and about 80% of our sludge disposal is handled through nine PFI contracts. And the first one of those expires in the end of 2021. So we'll have to go through quite a careful thought process here. Do we extend those contracts? Do we in some way continue some form of private sector participation, or do we bring them back in-house? Because fundamentally, wastewater treatment is part of our core competence.
If I could just build on that, Douglas, you mentioned customer service, just to give some information. I mean, clearly, our whole mantra is about putting customers at the heart of our business, and we have customer end-to-end processes which we've developed, and all of that work is carried out by in-house resources. So all of the operational response to customer issues is all in-house. There's about 90% of that work in total is carried out by in-house resources, and we use some contracted resource as a peak lopping when volumes go up too much, but primarily it's in-house resource. And if you look at it over the years, and the WIC report is a perfect example of that, where the WIC is calling out that we're delivering a leading level of service for one of the lowest costs in the UK, and that's been brought about by a real focus on driving up customer service and reducing costs and improving efficiency of our in-house people as well as the external contractors.
Hey, Forbes.
Very much. Going back just briefly to the 6-year investment programme, Scottish Water have stated that these three new alliances, which we've already discussed, have inevitably impacted on our rate of investment delivery, and there's been rephasing. Has that rephasing had a budget impact on any individual projects? Are any individual projects now over budget?
The way that we look at the thing is that in terms of the programme as a whole, the financing that we have is for delivering the programme. And the marginal change in phasing, and it is a very marginal change in phasing, has absolutely no impact at all on the total amount of financing that we are able to access to deliver that programme. So there's no impact for government or no impact for customers. In terms of individual projects, inevitably within a portfolio of projects, some projects you were able to deliver for much less than was originally anticipated, and inevitably there's some projects for whatever reasons are just inherently more challenging. So you get swings and roundabouts within individual projects, but our whole focus is about delivering the programme within the available financing.
In terms of just that comment that it's inevitably impacted on the rate of investment delivery, why has it been that the three new alliances have had that impact?
It's not so much the three new alliances. In fact, let me come back and say, in terms of the impact is so marginal that notwithstanding the rebaselining that was done, we still hit our end of year, what's called the overall measure of delivery target, on the original profile for delivery. So it was effectively during the year last year that things were off to a bit of a slow start that triggered the rebaselining, but actually by the time we got to the end of the year, we were effectively back on track when looking at an aggregate level. But what sat behind the recognition that this would be a sensible thing to do, this rebaselining, was really that we've made this very, very major change in our whole approach to investment planning delivery. This whole move to bringing the investment planning activity back in-house so we get the right solutions and understand all the various conditions before we get to site. That in itself is a big change. As, for example, we brought additional resources into our business and got people trained up. And then as we got the alliances on board. And the worst thing you can do in delivering an investment programme like ours is to rush to site too quickly. It's much better to take the time to get the scopes right and then to go to site. So I think it's one of these things with the glorious benefit of hindsight, we maybe should have allowed longer in our early thinking for how long it might take to make this major change in our mode of planning and delivery. But actually, in reality, we're still broadly on track to the original expectation.
Great.
Hamish.
Thank you. Good morning to you all. There are two specific questions that I've got that really relate to core competency, responsibility, and also investment. So I'll put them in here, although I wasn't quite sure where to ask them. In the previous Rural Affairs Committee, we had dialogue with Scottish Water about the purity of water for shellfish. And I wonder whether that's a competency that you could make any comment on and how that's developing, or whether it is indeed still a responsibility. And connected with that, if you have any responsibilities in relation to the aquaculture industry. And I don't know whether you do or not. I'm sorry I haven't done that research, but I haven't made the time, because there have been concerns from CEPA about pollution and in that way. And also something that's come up in the Parliament with a members' debate, and you've referred this morning already to the sewage treatment. And I'm wondering what your responsibilities are in relation to sewage sludge and the spreading of sewage sludge on farmland, and whether you have any responsibility or investment plans, if indeed you do have responsibility, for upgrading the from only drying to heating, so that the sewage sludge is more guaranteed not to have pathogens in it. So I've put all those questions out there, and whoever wants to answer them, and I apologise if they may not be within your competency, but they are sort of water-related.
Well, we'll do our very best to answer them, and if there are specifics...
If not, you could possibly write...
To come back, please do. let me just kick off on the shellfish one. Again, I'll root back some of the stuff covered earlier. So, ahead of any investment period on the wastewater side, SEPA in particular will look at areas where we need to make upgrades to our wastewater treatment facilities or indeed our networks to improve the quality of discharges to the aquatic environment. And it is very much SEPA who have the responsibility for understanding what is the environmental capacity of any particular water body to say, well, okay, what does Scottish Water need to do, or what do other landowners or other pressures on the environment, what do they need to do to play their part to make sure that particular water body is is protected? So in the case of a shellfish water, SEPA will look at the quality of our existing wastewater discharges, and they will determine whether the licence that we have at the moment is fit for purpose or whether that needs to be enhanced. If that licence needs to be tightened, then we would then assess whether we need to make further investment in our wastewater facilities to then meet the licence standards that will enable SEPA to be satisfied that the shellfish can be protected. I'll pass over to Peter then to talk about what we do from an operational perspective to make sure that we can comply, and then to pick up also on the issues on sludge.
Okay. In terms of sludge itself,
Could we firstly just clarify the point about the shellfish and the quality of water? Have there been any instances, and if you can't say necessarily today, could you please write to us about that?
Yeah.
Because it is of concern to constituents as to the quality of water who are working in the industry, but also more generally for the estuary and marine environment. Yeah.
I don't have any specifics on impact on shellfish waters, but what I can tell you in general is that our wastewater treatment works compliance, that's the compliance of the wastewater at the point of discharge, has been improving significantly over the years. We've got 1,827 wastewater treatment works, all with discharge points. And last year in this period, we had only six of those 1,827 that had failed a part of the SEPA compliance assessment that's carried out for that, and I'm not aware that any of those have had an impact on any shellfish waters.
It is obviously a very high level. I think it's level A
We'll certainly look into that in a bit more detail and send you any
because
details
because that could
of that.
Have investment implications.
Yep.
Right, and the sewage sludge issue?
Yeah, well, sewage sludge has for a long time been a part of Scottish Water's sludge strategy, and it's been long recognised in our industry as one of the best environmental options. So if you look at our sludge outlets at the moment, land provides an outlet for about 60% of our sewage sludge, and about 80% of that 60% goes to agriculture. The remaining amount is used as a fuel, so we've used that as a fuel at Longannet Power Station and then for a fuel in a different process now. We do a lot to make sure that the quality of the sludge is of the right standard, but there's a significant number of improvements that we're looking at the moment in conjunction with Water UK. Water UK have implemented what they're calling the UK Biosolids Assurance Scheme, and we're working with Water UK to make sure that as an industry that we're improving procedures and protocols for sludge management to make sure that when it does go out onto agriculture that's absolutely of the right standards and quality. I think probably one of the other things that I'd call out that we're doing is we're looking at different types of processes as well. So there's a process that we've been trialling which is called biothermic digestion, which is a high-temperature anaerobic digestion process, which not only makes sure that the sludge is absolutely of the right quality, but it also significantly reduces the volume of the sludge down by about 85 to 90% reduction in volume, which means that also impacts on transportation to agricultural fields, that reduces the amount of transportation and other environmental impacts.
All right, thank you for that answer.
Okay, Angus MacDonald.
Yes, Convener, as and when the PFI contracts that you mentioned earlier come to an end, what's the likelihood of increasing incineration of sewage sludge pellets? I've looked at figures in Sweden and the Netherlands where, you know, we're behind with regards to the number of incineration plants that we have. So what percentage of sewage is incinerated in Scotland at the moment, and what's the prospect of increasing the number of incinerators around the country?
As I said earlier, about 80% of our sludge is treated under PFI contract. And the single biggest one of those is a plant on the east side of Glasgow that takes about half of Scotland's sludge. And it's a drier process. It actually creates a pellet. And that pellet is then used as a fuel in kilns in a major manufacturing company as an energy substitute. So, that is, I think, a good example of the sludge being used effectively as a fuel source. That contract comes to an end in 2026. And I think there's going to be a major, major question for us about what is the right way for us to progress beyond then. So, for example, how might that's 10 years away. So how might technology move over the next 5 to 10 years that have an impact on what is the most sustainable way, and how do we get the most value from it? And I think one of the longer-term challenges is that we've got to move away from seeing wastewater activities as being a waste to be treated, to seeing it as actually a resource. And how can we maximise the value of recovery that we can get from the various waste streams? So an obvious starting point is how do we maximise the energy generation capacity from sludge? But what scope might we have in wastewater treatment plants in the future for higher levels of nutrient removal? Because some of the elements that sit in wastewater actually are naturally occurring chemicals that where there is a finite supply in the world. So can we, for example, start to recover phosphorus from wastewater streams? So I think some really interesting areas for us to look at in the future to try and enhance effectively the contribution that we can make to greater sustainability.
Okay, Joanna Dow has been sat patiently waiting for the last wee while, so we now move to business stream. Can I ask what the full impact on business stream has been of the loss of the public sector framework contract and the extent to which profits will be impacted going forward? And alongside that, I would be interested to hear on how you're preparing yourself for the opening of the English market and what benefits that might bring for Scottish consumers.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Loss of the public sector, we obviously had a significant period of time to prepare ourselves for the outcome there. So there was an extended period during which the contract was being considered. So that allowed us the opportunity to kind of prepare ourselves for all outcomes. So we used that time wisely and took the opportunity to restructure the business and to design processes that were, I would say, more customer focused and to position ourselves to be ready for the opening of the English market, but also to be able to compete more effectively within the Scottish market too. So there's no doubt that the loss of the public sector will have a significant impact on the business in the short term. However, as I say, we'd prepared for that as one potential outcome. In terms of readiness for the English market, the market in England opens now in 4 months' time on the 3rd of April 2017. That creates a huge opportunity for Business Stream. The size of the market in the south is roughly 8 times the size of the market that exists today in Scotland. I believe that we're ideally placed as an organisation to secure market share in the south. We've got 8 years of experience of operating in a competitive market here in Scotland. We know what customers want. We've taken the learnings from things that we haven't done that quite so well over the last 8 years, and we will plough those into compelling propositions for the south. So at the moment, we are going through a period of significant transformation as an organisation, focused particularly around the quality of the customer experience that we deliver. I think I'm very cognizant of the fact that we're quite different from Scottish Water in that we operate in a commercial environment within Scotland. So if a non-household customer isn't satisfied with the level of service that they get from Business Stream, they can choose to go to one of our 23 competitors. So for me, having taken on the role of Chief Exec 2 years ago at Business Stream, my focus is very firmly on how do we raise the quality of the customer experience that we're delivering for our customers across the UK. So I think, again, going back to England, I do feel that we're ideally placed to secure market share, but we'll do so in a very targeted manner, because we have to recognise that there's some segments of that market that we have a very strong, unique selling point to sell into, and I guess the geographical dispersity of where we secure customers will be really important as well.
Okay, you touched there upon what you might not have done well over the last 8 years. A very large proportion of the complaints that you receive relate to bills and charging. How do you respond to that stat, and what are you doing about it?
I think if I look again at the performance over the last 2 years, and more specifically over the last 6 months, we have had annually over the last 12 months about 1,000 complaints. Now that's from 100,000 customers. So I think the level of complaints that we have as an organisation are quite low. Having said that, I think my position on it is that, you know, we want to seek to deliver a quality of customer service so that we get it right for customers all the time. So if I look even at our statistics on customer complaints, in the first 6 months of this year, relative to the same period last year, we've reduced the number of customer complaints by 53%. In the latest figures that SPSO are reporting as well, the Ombudsman, they are reporting a 50% reduction in complaints that are being escalated to them on behalf of Business Stream as well. So if I go back to the point I made earlier, key focus for me in my role is about enhancing that customer experience. Now, I would love if we could do that overnight like this. The reality is quite different. It takes time to embed processes, systems, to train individuals. But what I would say just now is all of the indicators are definitely moving in the right direction. We measure customer satisfaction independently on a biannual basis. And the last set of results that were published 2 months ago show that continued upward trajectory in customer experience.
You said it's moving in the right direction, but you'll be aware of the evidence that's been given to the committee from the National Farmers Union and Scottish Land and Estates. And it's evidence that chimes with what many of us who represent rural areas here about your agricultural customers' experience with the company. How do you respond to the evidence that we've received?
I take the concerns that are raised really seriously. I've reached out to NFU and asked for specific details on the 5 cases that they've provided. And I've also offered them a single point of contact to deal with any issues that they have in future. And I've followed that up by saying that I'm very keen personally to meet with them to understand exactly what the concerns are that their constituents are raising. I think if you look, without going into the detail of the five cases that they've provided, by and large, the issues that are being drawn to our attention there are fairly complex issues, and we do find that particularly within the agricultural community, where there's often kind of lengthy infrastructure that sits on the farmer's land. There are instances quoted there of leaks. There are also shared supply issues where there's a joint supply that provides a domestic element in the farmhouse, but also the agricultural side too. So without wishing to make excuses, those particular issues are quite contentious and quite difficult to resolve. So from that perspective, what we are doing now is working much more closely with Scottish Water to seek a resolution of those particular issues.
I accept that, but there is a commonality about some of these complaints, particularly around the number of times that meters are being read, around whether or not people receive a leakage allowance or don't, when, as I understand it, in the days of Scottish Water, they did. Can we get some clarity on the record around those points? I think that's at the centre of much of the disgruntlement in the agricultural sector.
So if I take the point on meter reading first, over the last 12 months, we have attempted to read 84,000 meters. From those, there are only 9,000 meters that we've been unable to read. Now, the reasons for not being able to get a read vary, but the three common themes are that the meter's located internally within a premise and we can't get access to read it because maybe the property's vacant. There are access issues, so there may be that there's a health and safety issue which actually prevents safe reading of the meter. And the third category is where we're unable to locate the meter. So we have an obligation under the market code that governs the non-household market to provide at least two reads per annum for every customer. One of those reads can be provided by the customer. So although the requirement is two, one customer read, we endeavour to read all of our meters at least twice a year. We recognise the challenges and the fact that at the moment 10% of those meters were not being able to read, and what we're doing is introducing a series of different improvements there. So we have introduced an improved meter read schedule. We've appointed a third party to recalibrate that meter read schedule to make the, to increase the chance or the likelihood of being able to get a read. We've introduced a now an online portal as well that allows customers to actually log into that and provide details of a time which is most suitable for them to be in the property to be able to access it to get a meter read. And we've also introduced customer calling cards as well. So where we've been unable to get a meter read, we leave a card now with the business customer to actually give them alternative routes for being able to send us a meter read or indeed to be able to contact us to arrange a time and place that suits. So I think that's everything that we're doing on the meter read side. I should say that our performance in that area has significantly improved in the last 12 months as well. On the subject of leaks, this is always a really contentious issue. The policy that we apply for leak allowances is a Scottish Water policy. They maintain the assets, they grant the leakage allowance. That policy was formalised in 2008, but there really wasn't a change in the practice that was being employed. So really, to kind of summarise there, the customer is responsible for the pipework that exists between the boundary of their property and inside that boundary, basically. And Scottish Water are responsible for maintaining the infrastructure between the water main and the property boundary. So where a leak occurs on a customer's property and it's found to be caused by Scottish Water or one of their contractors, the customer is eligible for a leak allowance on that full amount. Where the leak occurs within the boundary and it's in effect the customer's responsibility, the leakage allowance that gets applied is only to the wastewater element of that, not to the water element. So again, a feature for many farmers is if they've got a septic tank, they have no connection to the waste network and they will find themselves in a situation therefore of not being eligible to apply for a leak allowance.
To be clear, how does that approach compare to prior to Business Stream when Scottish Water were doing this? Is there any change at all in approach?
I think we would need to, I think to be safe, we'd need to check that out.
That's fine. If you could write back to us, because they're out there in the public domain, there's a belief this is a different approach. We used to get useful to get clarity on that.
I think the further thing I would say is that Joe referred to the Scottish Water policy here, and all of these policies that impact market rules, but how we deal with not just business, but other licensed providers, we keep under review. And I think this whole issue about it purely applying to the wastewater element is something that is currently being reviewed at the present as to whether that should be extended onto the water side.
Thank you. I want to take this as a slightly different direction. Emma Harper, is your question about metering? Or mm-hmm. Yes, I'll let you in now then.
Okay, thank you, convener. Just a quick supplementary. I was at an NFU Dumfriesshire meeting last night and they brought up similar issues about meters. And one of the farmers said that his meter had been moved from the steading to a more remote area where you had to climb a bank and then get over a dike to get to it. So he thought that was a bit odd, especially if you're describing alternatives. But their problems are about poor communication, aggressive debt collection and meter placement. So if you've got any update on that. I know you've said that in the last 12 months you've done different, so it might be that they just haven't had the information yet.
The issue on meter location I'll leave to Peter, but if I covered a bit about the debt recovery process, again, we've had feedback from customers about the debt recovery process that we're following, and we have worked extensively with Consumer Futures on that process to try and make that debt recovery policy that we apply much more equitable for customers and to make customers aware that there are alternative payment options available for them. So I am quite happy to pick up on that specific issue if you want to drop me a note on it offline.
Okay, in terms of the meter location, clearly the meters should be put in a place that's easy to read. So I'm concerned if you're saying it's actually made it worse to read. However, what we have to take into account as well is that the meters need to be placed close to the point at which Scottish Water's pipework finishes, because if it is far up the private pipework, so if the farmer has a long private supply pipe up to the steading and the meter's up there, there's a significant length of pipe that there is no measurement of any potential leakages or loss on that. So meters are generally placed at the point where there's the interface between Scottish Water's pipework and the farmers, but I can look into that specific issue just to see if it's been put in a place that is not easy to read, because it shouldn't be.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Joanna Dow, you said that you had taken up these particular cases that have been highlighted by the NFUS. I'd be grateful if you would look into the SLE one as well. That's a constituent of mine. I had a query on interest. But what's quite clear from the evidence we've had is that there is a disconnect in the relationship, it would appear, between agriculture and their dealings with yourselves. And it would be reassuring to be advised that this is a more general point that's going to be looked at in detail. And if you can give us that commitment, can I add something else in? I've been contacted by a farmer who's telling me that, rightly or wrongly, that Business Stream are sending out reminders on the same day as invoices requiring payment within 14 days are going out. Would that be right?
If that is happening, it will be an isolated instance. Our debt recovery process doesn't trigger a first recovery letter until 14 days after the bill has been issued. So if there's the two things are landing consecutively, then you know clearly that is an isolated incident, not something that we're intending to do.
Okay, I'll maybe discuss that with you later
about the
specifics of that case. But also the fact 14-day payment terms, that seems rather short for a business, doesn't it?
Under the market rules that we operate within, there is a default level of service standard and a default price that goes with that. Actually, for water customers, typically the payment terms, unless they're negotiated something different, is payments due on demand. So we allow 14-day period of grace before we would start that debt recovery process, but the invoices themselves are due and payable on demand unless the customer has negotiated something different with
us. And that's laid down for you to follow?
That is the default service standard that applies for that default price that gets regulated by the industry.
Yeah, it's just I suspect Scottish Water and Business Stream take longer than 14 days to pay their customers.
If I'm perfectly honest with you, we allow tolerance around that as well. So we start with a very gentle reminder on day 14, and the actual debt recovery process itself is very extended.
So how long do your organisations take to pay customers, suppliers rather, set against this procedure?
It would depend on the specific supplier that we were contracting with, but I would say that typically our average payment timescales are probably about 28 days.
Right. Corey Beamish. Sorry, I'll let Douglas Milligan. I didn't give him the opportunity to respond. Sorry.
The precise number is set out in our annual report and accounts. I'm just trying to find it at the moment, but it is very 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 prompt. And I think an interesting reflection is that I recruited my finance director out of the private sector 3 years ago, and he was struck just how promptly we pay our suppliers. So I think that's absolutely right and proper that we do that. It's part of our duties as a public body. And it's part of the commitment that we've made as a business in signing up to the Scottish Business Pledge.
Yeah, and that's welcome. I'm just drawing the comparison between how quickly you may pay your suppliers and how quickly Business Stream are requiring their customers to pay up. Claudia Beamish.
Just a brief supplementary on that for you, Joe. Could you just clarify when you say that that's the default situation? Is that something that Scottish Water, in view of if there's more evidence and what has been provided today about concerns, about the speedy expectation with which people are expected to pay, is there any way in which you might review that?
I mean,
if it's a default, I'm not quite sure what you mean by a default.
So the default is a reference to the default set of retail charges that exist within the water industry in Scotland. So if I go back to my earlier point about Business Stream being one of 24 competitors in that market, what the regulator does each year is sets a default price for retail charges under the expectation that retailers will charge less than that where they can. And with that default price comes a default set of service standards. So that's the default position that I refer to. Now, as I said before, we have been working very proactively with consumer futures in this space, looking at particular issues that customers have expressed about debt recovery practices, looking at payment terms as well. So we'd happily take on board any additional feedback that you've got to put into that process.
Right, thank you.
Mark Roscoe.
If the WIC sets the default service standard, to what extent is the WIC open to the incidents that we've heard today and the concerns from customers? I mean, do they take on board the views of customers and stakeholders, or is there a role for ministerial direction there?
I think the WICs very much take on board the views of customers. Customers can contact WICs directly if they have specific concerns. I've already mentioned the SPSO as well, the ombudsman who operates in this space too. So I think there's certainly numerous avenues for customers to explore. We're more than happy to address these issues direct if we understand exactly what the concerns are.
That's an issue for the WIC. It's not an issue for you because you're in a regulated market and they set the standards.
There's set default standards, but as I said to you before, for us to retain customers, we need to be constantly raising the bar from a service perspective. So there's nothing preventing us doing something different from those default standards.
Okay. Moving on, Maurice Golden.
So this section's around non-regulated businesses and the wider economic impact. And I'd just firstly like to ask you about Scottish Water Horizons. And in particular, you've highlighted a number of renewable technologies that you are currently involved in, from hydroturbines to heat from sewers. And I was wondering, firstly, obviously, there's been lower profits over the last year versus previous years. What are the prospects going forward, both in terms of profit, but certainly for me and this committee, more importantly, your investment in those renewable technologies and, you know, their potential to impact positively on climate change?
The Horizons is effectively an umbrella body through which we develop all the activities that exploit the assets, the resources, the intellectual property that we have as an organisation that sits outside, if you like, our core regulated service of water supply and wastewater service. And therefore, there's really quite a diversity of activities that sit there. And there's quite an entrepreneurial culture. So it's one where they're always in the business of looking at new opportunities. So what I can talk to you about is what's on the horizon now, but equally that could change over time. So in terms of the renewable side, they've played a really significant role in recent years in putting in photovoltaic panels, in putting in small-scale wind turbines, in putting in hydro turbine facilities. But in the last year, the new one for them was heat from sewage. And the pioneering scheme, and it's a UK first, is in Galley Shields, where effectively the sewer feeding Galley Shields wastewater treatment works is intercepted, and a heat is taken out of that to power the college, the Scottish Borders College there in the town. And what's emerged from that? We've now entered into a much wider partnership with the developer there, a company called Shark Energy. So look at where else can we apply this across Scotland? And I think the short answer is there is lots of scope. And I think the preconditions that really to make it work from a technical and a commercial angle is you need clearly access to a wastewater pipe or sewer in close proximity to customers. But it works best probably with public sector customers, where there is a prospect that actually they will have longevity and that the investment can be made in the heat transfer technology against a secure income stream from a public sector customer. So I was referencing earlier today to my meeting with the chief executive of Stirling Council. So for example, in Stirling, there is a very live scheme that's being looked at. There are a number across Scotland. Now, how many of those will come off? Only time will tell. But clearly, wherever there is scope to deploy the model in a commercially successful way, we will pursue that. But then equally over time, as new innovations come in, you can either get access to new technologies or the cost of technology drops. So maybe something that wasn't commercially viable yesterday becomes commercially viable in the future. But when I look out into the medium term, I think from heat from sewage is the most exciting prospect that lies ahead of us in the next few years.
And just, it's quite interesting from looking at this, because you mentioned previously kind of 4 to 7 year payback terms, and many other chief execs in a more commercial environment think that's too long. In terms of water-based heat pumps or taking heat from sewage, are you willing, it seems like you are, to take that longer term approach and allow, you know, the payback period to be extended? And is that going to reflect on the profitability overall of Horizons?
Okay, the model that we have here is that we're effectively, through Horizons, we're an enabler. Mm-hmm. And it is Shark Energy are the company who are investing the technology and then doing all the, if you like, the hookup with the heating systems within the public sector body. So it is for them to take a view on the period in which they require a commercial return. But undoubtedly, if they've got public sector clients who are signing up to long-term contracts and with a secure revenue stream, then that inherently reduces some of the risk associated with the scheme and therefore will allow them to take a much longer-term view in terms of the required period for payback. But that's certainly the current commercial model that we have.
Okay. Thanks for that. And secondly, looking at Scottish Water International, I thought it was interesting the kind of four strategic target markets, but also again, profit before tax is down. I was just wondering how you see that expanding. Also, in some of those nations, there are individual statutory bodies that are doing consultancy services of their own, such as my former colleagues in the Murray-Darling River Basin Commission, now authority. I was just wondering how you see that expanding and, you know, how you can take particularly some of the environmental technologies that you are leading in and exporting that across the globe.
When I look at it from a profit angle, effectively, the profit streams we've had historically have come from two sources. They've come from people that we deploy and effectively the fees that we charge for those, and to a degree from the sale of intellectual property in the form of operating manuals and the like. And that's what can contribute a wee bit to the lumpiness in the profit stream. But I think when you look at the profits in ratio to turnover, they are strong. It is. We've now been operating this business for 4 to 5 years, and I think as time goes on, we will refine the approach that we take. Because in some sense, our unique selling point is that we are a commercially successful water company, but in public ownership. And in most places in the world, water continues to be in public ownership. And therefore, there's quite a degree of interest in how do you run a commercially successful water company with a focus on customer service and efficiency while in public ownership. And a lot of that interest isn't about, you know, having lots of people on the ground for extended periods of time. It is about the sharing of knowledge and expertise, often over quite short periods of time. So I think that we may move our model. It may be involve fewer people actually permanently overseas and more perhaps more people going for shorter durations on assignment. So if I talk about Qatar, we've been working there for the last 4 to 5 years. That contract comes to an end in March next year. Ireland is kind of a growth area for us at the moment because there's effectively the creation of a body of Irish Water, which has got certain similarities to Scottish Water in that it's in public ownership, albeit its operations are currently spread through the local authorities. And we're engaged in a number of different contracts in supporting Irish Water with that core challenge of how do you become commercially successful while in public ownership.
And just looking going forward, would you consider link-ups with either Scottish-based SMEs or businesses as part of that export market so that, you know, you can provide, as well as the people and the expertise, you can perhaps provide further technological solutions and maximise the benefits we have in terms of Scottish Development International in terms of building this portfolio up?
Absolutely. And I think there's many ways that this could develop going forward, and it is absolutely the case of how can we maximise the value and the benefits that we have right across the broader water sector in Scotland to maximise the export potential for Scotland.
Great, thanks, Jenny. Good morning to the panel. In terms of that longer-term view you spoke of, Douglas, with regards to the workforce going forward, I understand that you offer a number of training opportunities for young people through STEM subjects and also to women, but you are cognizant that only a quarter, I think just over, of your workforce is currently female. So firstly, how does Scottish Water seek to tackle that gender segregation in the workforce? And secondly, with regard to STEM subjects and training, is any of this work tagged at all to Scottish Government ambitions with regard to closing the attainment gap?
There's a huge amount of work that we do in this whole area, and at many different levels. So I could pull many themes. So for example, on diversity as a whole, we've got a huge focus on trying to recognise and value diversity in our workforce. So I'll give you one example. Twice a year, as an executive team, we get face-to-face with everybody in a leadership position in Scottish Water. And we've got about 600 people in leadership positions across the business. And probably the single biggest topic that we focused on in our sessions last month in November, was the whole area of diversity and inclusion and how we encourage diversity, absolutely in gender, but also in all the other aspects of the protected characteristics. But if I stick specifically with the gender one, while the figures you quoted are for the workforce as a whole, if I look at some of our sort of our kind of first level professional roles, 40% of our people at that level are female. If I look at our future leadership development program, 63% of the participants are female. So you know, there's a huge amount that we do to encourage there. If I come back to STEM, we have a real focus on STEM in terms of the bias for our graduate intake, particularly looking to recruit people from STEM backgrounds. And we do quite a lot of work right down into schools and trying to encourage young people to consider careers in engineering as part of that.
Take you back, sorry, to the international question. Cordia Beamish has a brief supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Just to ask you whether you have considered or would consider the possibility of opportunities to support countries or states or regions internationally in dialogue with the Scottish Government. For instance, in relation to the Climate Justice Fund or anything like that, because while I appreciate that, especially in the context of slightly lower profits for the international aspects of your role, that would be a challenge. I think it is important as a public body perhaps to send that kind of a message, and an international opportunity might be available.
I absolutely agree with that. So two or three different aspects to tease out. For a long, long time, we've had a strong commitment through the charity WaterAid. So there's a lot of work that we do through WaterAid to support international development work. In fact, we had a team out in Zambia in the last year or so. And we're actively in dialogue with the Scottish Government about what else we might formalise through international and with WaterAid to support work, you know, in a particular country. So I think it is quite it's a rich area to pursue, but I think what we need to recognise is that clearly the specific needs in many developing countries are quite different to the areas where we have, if you like, our core expertise. So it's probably how we work in partnership with people in another country that will be appropriate.
Thank you.
Mark Roscoe.
Note that one of your key international target markets is Canada, and I'm wondering to what extent you've analysed the opportunities but also the threats that may arise from the Comprehensive Economic Trade Agreement.
I'm not going to comment on that latter point, because it's not something that I personally am familiar with. And I think in terms of Canada, the work that we've done to date has all been in Alberta. We did work some years ago in helping to develop drinking water safety plans. And more recently, we worked with the City of Calgary in doing a review of how they could improve the efficiency of two different aspects of their water service activities. And what I should say about international is that we're setting it up to respond to opportunities where they genuinely exist. We're not resourcing international with lots of people who we've got to go and find work just simply to, if you like, to employ them and to ensure that their costs are covered. We're responding to where there are real market opportunities and bringing people in on secondment from Scottish Water to then fulfil where there are real needs.
But could your public sector status be challenged under CETA? Have you done any analysis on that?
I think that's a question I would need to take away and give a response to.
It gets signed in a couple of weeks' time, so time's running out a bit. If you think there are opportunities or threats involved with it.
Yeah, no, that's
just
fine.
Just with a view on that as quick as you could. Moving on to the issue of vulnerable customers, Jenny Goldruth.
Thank you, Convener. I appreciate that Scottish Water don't bill their customers directly. Obviously, that's through the local authority. However, I think there is a level of confusion amongst those who perhaps are exempt from paying council tax, for example, and then assume that they are equally exempt from paying water charges. And indeed, the Citizens Advice report, which was published last year, flagged up that some authorities have been applying to the DWP to make additional deductions from people's benefits through the Water Direct scheme. So, firstly, what do you see as Scottish Water's social responsibility in terms of protecting vulnerable people? And secondly, are you aware of the extent to which the Water Direct scheme is being used by local authorities across the country?
So probably a number of different points to tease out here. The first one of which it goes back to that point I made really at the very beginning, that it's ministers who set the principles of charging that apply. And at the heart of that is something that is very, very powerful, which is all about how do we make sure that water charges are as low as possible and as affordable as possible for all our customers. So there's a huge amount of protection built into the inherent charging structure, partly because of the way it mirrors the council tax structure, but also the fact of the discounts that can be accessed. Over 20% of our household customers qualify for some form of support. Now, that's not free, that comes at a cost. So that comes at a cost of about £36 million that's borne by all our other customers. Second thing I want to say is, again, to try and help make things as affordable as possible, it is in all our customers' interests that we maximise the level of collection of water charges, because any uncollected water charges fall as a burden on those customers who do pay their bills. And that's why we have been working with local authorities very successfully over many years to drive up the level of collections. In terms of the specifics of the Water Direct scheme, you know, that has been piloted in a couple of local authority areas. It's been rolled out to a few others. And certainly the feedback that we've had from one of the pilot areas is that they've had very little complaint about it. But this will all be closely monitored by us and indeed by the Scottish Government. And findings from this will feed into the long-term charging review that will inform principles of charging for the 2021 to 27 period.
Okay, moving on, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. We move on to climate change issues, and I'll start by asking the panel some questions about mitigation before we move to adaptation with my committee colleague, Mark. As you'll know, the Part 4 of the Climate Change Act places duties on public bodies, and also in 2014, Scottish ministers gave additional direction to Scottish Water in relating to climate change mitigation. And that included, as well as some direct greenhouse gas emissions, it also focused on energy use specifically. I'm not sure who'd like to answer this or whether it's a range of the panel today, but could you please let us know what emissions reduction Scottish Water has achieved to date, and how these compare with Scotland's emissions target to cut emissions by at least 42% by 2020. And where you consider that there is investment decisions might need to be made with the potential to reduce climate change emissions, over what timescales do you consider cost effectiveness of such a decision payback, and what payback periods do you consider as cost effective? I know that's rather a broad and also detailed question at the same time, so if you want to write on some of those issues to us, but it would be helpful to understand, especially in view of the sharing of information between public bodies, which you'll know the public sector forum which you were represented on in the previous session has made a big contribution to.
So a number of different points here, so we'll do our best to try and address them. I think the starting point to recognise is that the very act of providing really high quality drinking water and the quality of treatment we now provide to wastewater discharges, those are inherently energy consumptive activities. So if I even link this back to one of the earlier questions around protecting shellfish waters, had to make major investment in Stranraer to improve the quality of wastewater discharges to Loch Ryan, very much with a view partly to complying with the Urban Wastewater Treatment Directive, but also to deal with protecting the shellfish waters there in Loch Ryan. What that scheme has ended up doing is taking the treated wastewater up over the hill and down to the Irish Sea. And that alone has got an energy consumption they've expressed in pound notes is £500,000 a year energy consumption. So I think it's just really important to recognise that in our efforts to improve whether it's drinking water or improving quality discharges to the aquatic environment, there is inherently an energy consumption built into that. Now, notwithstanding that inherent increasing demand for energy over the last many years, we've achieved year-on-year reductions in, effectively, the carbon consumed in our activities. You're going back over a 10-year period. So, for example, just in the last year alone, we achieved a further 3.5% reduction in carbon footprint. And at the heart of the work that we do in this area, and I'll let Peter expand on this, is looking at what can we do to improve the energy efficiency of our activities. So leakage reduction is a good example of that. What can we do to improve the energy efficiency of activities? And secondly, what can we do to increase the amount of renewable energy we consume, and particularly renewable energy generated close to the point at which we need to consume it?
Okay, so we're doing significant amount on energy efficiency, particularly at treatment works. So, for example, we can put in far more energy efficient pumps and motors from a number of years ago. So when we're doing capital maintenance to upgrade works, if we put in energy efficient pumps and motors, that can produce a significant benefit. There's a number of control systems that we're putting in place to control our processes so that they only come on when absolutely needed. So more automation of treatment works drives significant energy reductions. So significant things that we're doing to reduce energy over our whole stock of assets, really.
Thank you.
Well, that within Business Stream, as well as being very aware of our own environmental footprint, what we have delivered over the last 8 years has helped our customers to focus on using less water. So as a consequence of that, we've helped our customers to deliver a 24 billion litre reduction in the amount of water that's used, and that equates to 42,000 tonnes of carbon saved. So I think as an organisation, we're very aware of the link between helping customers use less water and the energy impact that goes with that too.
Just ask you finally for some detail, if not now, then in writing about have you done any assessment of energy use and dropping energy use in and possibly demand in buildings, and also your fleet, and also the workforce, whether you've had any projects or intend to have projects about raising awareness of these issues with your workforce?
No, I absolutely. I mean, there's a lot of activity right across the board there. I mean, at the heart of Scottish Water, in terms of our business, is we're in the business of protecting public health and protecting the environment. So that whole kind of the sustainability aspects that sit with that flow right through our activities. So many particular examples that we could give in response, and we can provide something in writing on that.
Right, and they may be good stories in terms of your profits as well, if it was in relation to making, you know, they're not mutually exclusive.
No, absolutely. And the great benefit of the model that we have is the savings that we make all flow back to our customers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mark Roscoe.
Thanks, Convener. So just turning now to the flip side of climate change and adaptation, what's your approach as an organisation to assessing what those risks are? And there's clearly a number of ones which are quite high profile around the capacity of the sewage system, around water shortages, around good ecological condition of our water resources as well. And I see those as the main ones, but what kind of assessments do you, what kind of long-term thinking are you currently undertaking?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are many challenges that the changing climate is already bringing us, never mind what will come in the years and decades to come. And probably the most obvious is in terms of the impact of more intense storms. So that can as you highlighted, can obviously, in terms of the impact that then has in the adequacy of the capacity in our sewer systems, but also it's got an impact in terms of what it does on runoff from hillsides into the water bodies where we abstract water from drinking water purposes. So, for example, if you take somewhere like Aberdeen, the two water treatment plants we have serving Aberdeen abstract the water from the River Dee. So when you get more intense storms upstream in the catchment there, then you can get more organic material effectively being washed down off the hillsides and into the river, and that can create a greater load that we have to then to treat and deal with. So that will cause changes over time in terms of additional filtration that we need to put in place to make sure we can take out that organic load before it goes through the full treatment process. But if I look at the main area, which is really probably the sewer capacity, the first area that we looked at in earnest in this was Glasgow. And I referenced earlier all the investment we're doing in Glasgow. And the genesis of this was storms back in the summer of 2002, when the east end of Glasgow was inundated with excess surface water. So since then, we worked in partnership, and that's a really key aspect here. We worked in partnership with other public bodies such as Glasgow City Council, SEPA, Clyde Gateway, to assess what are all the different issues that need to be looked at on a multi-agency basis to then come up with the right holistic solutions, whether we deliver them on our own, whether the City Council, what can be done by way of preventative measures to actually hold surface water at source, as, for example, Clyde Gateway have done as part of their development. So taking the success of that partnership model, in the 2010 to 15 period, we then developed 5 integrated catchment studies in 5 of the major other urban areas in Scotland, where we took a lead role working with the local authorities. And again, it's looking at the interplay between the sewer systems and surface water flows. Having done that in the 10 to 15 period, in this new period, 15 to 21, we're now doing a further 15 integrated catchment studies. And with all these studies, once they're completed, then the next stage is then to actually look at, well, what are the options that could be developed, and then to progress those into future investment plans. The other kind of area that we've looked at in the past, but we'll need to keep looking at, is assessing the flood risk to some of our critical assets. So we've done a lot of work to improve the ability of our, say, water treatment plants or pumping stations to withstand major flood events. But clearly, in the context of a changing climate, what might be appropriate in 2016 may not be appropriate in 2026 or 2036. So we will need to keep that under review as we go forward. Then probably the other area to highlight is what we need to do from a drought resilience angle. We've done quite a bit of work in recent years to improve the security of supply in a lot of our water resource zones. Clearly, the work we've done, for example, on reducing leakage has helped with that too, but we've raised dam levels in some of our reservoirs to give us greater storage and greater resilience to extended periods of drought. But it's another area that we will keep under review as we go forward.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, some of the projects you point to there, there's a wider holistic benefit. I'm thinking, you know, in particular at Loch Katrin and some of the work that you've done there, you know, in terms of forestry. And
yes.
But, I mean, isn't there a danger there that the WIC could turn around and say, well, this is all very well, but at the end of the day, this isn't delivering the lowest cost to consumers. This isn't investing in what we want you to invest in terms of a water supply system. So how do you square that? I mean, the challenges in terms of you being an economically regulated industry, which clearly has the opportunity to spread wider benefits into other areas of public policy.
I think that's quite an easy one to deal with. And it comes back, I think, to part of the elegance of the Scottish water industry system, where it's effectively the ministers that sit at the pinnacle of the decision-making tree. So it's ministers who set the investment objectives, the priorities, the service standards we must achieve, and then the responsibility of the economic regulator is to determine the lowest reasonable overall cost of delivering ministers' objectives. So their economic assessment is not in relation to their view of priorities, it's in relation to ministers' views of priorities.
Claudia Beamish.
Just very briefly, in relation to the adaptation, your Water Resource Plan 2015, which I've looked at the summary report of, does have 11 different scenarios for the risks to water of climate change. It might seem a bit odd here in Scotland to talk about the lack of resource, but the let's hope we don't get to the most serious scenario, but that has very serious implications. And I wonder how you're able to really rationalise planning for something that may never happen, because if it did, it would be very serious for the people of Scotland and their access to water.
Well, I mean, the heart of all of this is risk assessment. And I think it's really important when we're looking at water supplies is not to think about Scotland, but you've got to think about individual areas. So, for example, in areas that tend to have naturally high rainfall, associated with naturally high rainfall, for example, the Western Isles, we've seen in recent years when we've had extended dry periods that we've come across particular challenges. So you've got to look at what are appropriate solutions for particular areas. But over time, we certainly in a mainland sense, we're going to look at how we can join up different water supply areas. So, for example, at the moment, we're currently got investment linking up the water supply system in Ayrshire to Glasgow. And we're doing that for a number of different resilience objectives, recognising that risks and can take different forms, and indeed the events can take different forms. But how can we build more resilience in the system to deal with whether it's weather issues or infrastructure failure issues? Because I guess at heart, as a business, we plan to deliver consistently great service, but there are two challenges that are ever before us, and that's the climate and infrastructure failure. And both of you, both of those will happen to different degrees. So our job is, how can we cost effectively build as much resilience into the system as possible? But at the end of the day, we will never be able to invest, or we'll never be able to afford to invest as a country to cater for every possible eventuality. I think it's just something that we, together with our other regulators and government, just need to keep under review as we go forward, to always keep determining, okay, so what's appropriate to do looking at the next 5 to 10 years.
Okay. Slightly different subject, but peatland restoration is accepted as having climate change as well as biodiversity benefits, but it can also benefit water quality. I just want to explore briefly whether Scottish Water helps fund peatland restoration projects in the vicinity of reservoir catchments.
Okay, I'll take that one. So, presently, we've not undertaken any peatland restoration, but we have done significant investigations into areas where there may be, which may be suitable for restoration projects. So in SR15, this regulatory period, we've got a project currently on the go to survey and monitor 21 of our water treatment works with regard to the condition of peatlands, because it can have a big impact on organic carbon, THM production at our treatment works, for example. And so far, we've identified a few sites which we will take into our regulatory process. So, and it's called IR18. So there was a chunk of money that wasn't allocated to particular projects in our regulatory programme. We'll be taking issues like this to a review at this IR18 process to make sure that we can get some funding to deal with these restoration issues in the latter part of this regulatory period.
Okay, that's very good news. I think that's very welcome. Moving on then, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard a little bit about some of your circular economy activities already. I wonder if you could say a little bit more around any work you've been conducting, and you've mentioned some of this already, on phosphorus and priority substance recovery, and also around anaerobic digestion.
I mean, I think it's this is all fairly early stage work, and it's looking at what is the art of the possible, and particularly in terms of what can be done cost effectively. There are countries that are further advanced in nutrient recovery than we are, but I think. Certainly at the moment, it would be quite challenging for us from an economic perspective. But it's absolutely something that we're looking at as we look at our planning for the 2021 to 27 period. What scope is there? Even scope in terms of potentially how we design wastewater treatment plants in the future to support that nutrient recovery.
I think one of the other things on that is to try and facilitate that. We've created two development centres on redundant assets that we have, one at Water Treatment Works and one at Wastewater Treatment Works, where we've opened these up to technology companies to work with us to try and find and pilot new technologies to deal with issues like that. But it's early stages of the process.
I mean, there's a declare an interest because I set it up, but there's a small business research initiative at the moment that's live, that's funded by Scottish Government, Highlands and Islands Enterprise and Zero Waste Scotland, looking at phosphorus and priority substance. And I think, you know, Scottish Water are ideally placed to support that and support particularly those Scottish small businesses that are currently looking at that. So I think it's welcome to hear that you incorporate that into your planning. In terms of Deer Dykes, obviously there was, and feel free to come back on that initial point. But in terms of Deer Dykes in particular, obviously there's been some historic issues with respect to odour around that from 2012 that are now firmly in the past as of October this year. And I was just wondering if you see that as a technology that you'll continue to look at, particularly from a committee point of view, for solutions in rural areas and with the use of food waste in our island and rural communities.
I think it's always important to recognise what is the core competence of a business, and to really exploit the core competence, but recognise where other people may be better placed to meet a particular market need or opportunity. So we've got this waste facility at Deer Dykes. It takes food waste and converts it to energy. And we've learned a lot about that operation over the last few years, and we're increasing the efficiency and the output that we're getting from it. But I'm not sure that we'd ever view that as a core competence of Scottish Water that we would choose to invest in to scale up. I think there are better places in which we can get effectively a better return as Scottish Water. So I think in future, if there was, I mean, what the genesis of that was, it was a redundant wastewater treatment works that we convert into that. I think if we were to come across similar circumstances in the future, we would look pretty hard at whether we were best placed to exploit that, or indeed to bring in a private sector partner to exploit that.
It's more difficult than it looks, AD facilities getting it right. In terms of any either support or obviously from a legislative point of view that you think may help you to deliver a more circular approach going forward. I'm thinking in terms of either in planning or in separate collections of food waste in rural areas or any other areas that may be of assistance. Is there anything you'd like to highlight to the committee, bearing in mind there will be a circular economy and zero waste bill coming up?
I don't think that we see any legal impediments to what we need to do. I think the challenge for us is partly how innovative can we be, but crucially, how well connected can we be with other partners, whether those are public sector partners, whether it's academia or private sector companies, and particularly, you know, maybe early phase entrepreneurial companies, to make sure that we're working in as collaborative and joined up a way as we can to maximise the opportunities that we can. I think, as you've asked the question, and I may be in a sense slightly preempting another area that you want to come on to, but just because you asked the question on legislative change, I think the only thing that strikes us from a legal angle that's maybe a bit out of step with where we need to be and is absent on our radar is the current allocation of legal responsibilities to do with sewage spills on farmland. And that's something that we recognise is probably a bit out of step with where it needs to be in 2016, because it's rooted in 1968 law, and that's something that we will be taking forward in discussion with the Scottish Government as we go forward.
Thanks.
If I could just pick up as well on the issue of the circular economy, particularly you mentioned anaerobic digestion. We're doing a significant a number of works in this area. So, for example, a really positive thing recently, so in September 2016 this year, we've just successfully connected up our Girvan wastewater treatment works down in Ayrshire to a local farmer who has built and developed an anaerobic digester using farm waste and other products to produce electricity, which we use at the treatment works. So it's reducing our need for fossil fuels and also reducing waste on site. So that's a perfect example there that we're working with the rural community with.
Okay, thank you. Alexander Burnett.
You mentioned there were six pollution incidents, I think, in the last year. There's been a slight increase in both higher and lower category pollution events between 2014 and 2015-16. I think as people who live downstream of some of these sewage works, live and work there, including myself, might contend that there are more incidents than are being reported. Can you comment on why the very slight increase, why you think there's low public confidence in the assessment and reporting of incidents, and how many pollution incidents actually went to the Procurator Fiscal, and what, if any, fines were levied?
Okay, the first part of that, there's a slight increase in 15-16 in total events, pollution events. Now, Douglas mentioned earlier about last year, our investment took a bit of time to kick off in the early parts of the year. I think that potentially had an impact on our ability to quickly deal with some of the issues there. But what I can say is that we've had some further reductions this year, and we're on track for a 10% reduction in the total number this year. So that has started to move at the pace that we would expect. If you look at that in the wider context, since we started looking at this back in 2010-11, so over the 5 years, the total number of pollution incidents has reduced from 824 back in 10-11 to 257 in this period. So that's a 70% reduction in pollution events over that period. So we have really been focusing on that and had significant benefits coming through on that. And as I said, we are continuing the focus on that. We work very closely with SEPA in terms of the categorisation of the events. And I would say that I'm fairly confident that we are now reporting all pollution events, or the majority of pollution events, because they're self-reported by us. SEPA, through investigations and going around the catchment, pick them up. But also we get significant numbers reported by members of the public themselves. So I'm fairly confident that the pollution events are certainly being notified to us, and we have got some significant projects on the go to improve this even further. So if I just talk about some of the improvements that we're focusing on, bearing in mind that we are a heavy asset-based industry, we've got 1,800 wastewater treatment works, each of them with the potential for pollution, the discharge back to the environment, and we've got 50,000 kilometres of sewers across the whole of Scotland, again with relief points and overflows that are designed into the system. The majority of our pollution incidents are coming from the network themselves. I mentioned earlier 1,800 wastewater treatment works, and only six of those failing the parameters that are set for them just now. So the majority are coming from the network. So some of the things that we're doing to improve that even further, we're looking at targeted proactive sewer maintenance. So we're going in and clearing out sewers to make sure they are at full capacity. And if they're at full capacity, they can deal with the flows a lot better and stop discharges. Obviously, if grit and debris is allowed to settle out in the sewers, it can impact on the capacity of the sewer and lead to discharges. We are increasing maintenance at pumping stations to take out more of the debris that goes into the sewer so it doesn't deposit in the networks and cause discharges. You'll also probably be aware of our customer behavioural campaigns that have been on the TV. One of the main elements of that is to try and inform our customers about putting things down the toilets that shouldn't be going down the toilets, because these cause significant numbers of blockages and therefore overflows and pollution events. That can be caused by wipes, fats, oils and greases. So our campaign is all about trying to help our customers to help us to have a more efficient operating system. And the final thing that we're looking at just now we've run a pilot on this, is putting low-cost sensors on our sewer network to detect flows and levels quickly through our 24/7 control centre, so that when levels start to rise in sewers, we can go out to them proactively and clear any blockages before they actually lead to an overflow or a pollution event that happens after the event. So that's quite a big area for our focus going forward.
Thank you. Having had to watch videos of sewage pipes, I certainly sympathise with your efforts to educate communities and what can go down the toilet. on the element of you mentioned that you're self-reporting when it comes to incidents. Do you think that contributes to some of the public confidence in, you know, if you're regulating yourself, how thorough is it being done? Is there anything you think you can do to maybe improve the transparency of how you're reporting and what self-reporting is going on? I think that's certainly something that gets mentioned to us.
Two or three things in this. I mean, firstly, the number of pollution incidents is a combination of what we identify, what's reported by members of the public, and what gets reported through CEPA. So it's not just ourselves. But I think the biggest challenge we're here is the one that Peter referred to at the end, and that is us understanding what's happening. But this is the area of our network where we've got the least intelligence. So we don't know today when sewer overflows are going off with you at times, frankly, might be dry weather and they shouldn't be going off. And that's why I think at the heart of this is how do we use smart technology to give us the eyes and ears across all these overflows about when there may be pollution going on so we can go and investigate. And I think that's going to be an investment that's going to take us well into the next regulatory period to actually secure the financing we need to get that deployed, because that's going to be big. But that is going to be the transformational step that we need to give us the intelligence so we can go out and deal with things much more quickly than simply when we're responding to either things we find ourselves or reported by customers.
David Angus MacDonald.
The NFUS has highlighted numerous issues in recent years where sewage sludge has spilled onto farmland. And the NFUS have flagged up that the current law puts the onus on the farmer to prove that Scottish Water is liable when it comes to any damage caused by sewage spills on farmland, rather than Scottish Water to prove that they are not liable. Now, NFUS feel, as you would expect, that the issue should be changed in law, as this onus is the wrong way around. And I'd be interested to hear your views on that.
I think this is an issue that we've got a fair degree of sympathy for, and that's why I mentioned earlier when I was asked about the question of did we anticipate the need for any legislative change. I think this is the one area where I think that the law, because it was written nearly 50 years ago, is just out of step with what would be current customer service expectations and practice. So I think it's something that we do need to look at with the Scottish Government, either to look at formalising a change in approach for the next period, or whether that also gets accompanied by a legislative change as well. So it is something that is absolutely on our radar.
Yes, thanks for that. It's good to have that on record.
I think I should draw to a conclusion what has been an incredibly comprehensive first session between this committee and yourselves. Can I welcome the evidence you've given? Clearly, there are a number of matters that you've undertaken to write back to us on, Mr. Milliken. That would be appreciated if it could be done as quickly as convenient. Joanna Dow, we would obviously welcome an update as your discussions with the NFUS and SLE, not only around the specific points that have been raised today, but the broader issues that exist. So if it were possible for you to write back and advise the committee of how that's worked out, I think that would be good as well. So thank you for your time today. We now move to the third item on the agenda, which is subordinate legislation. This is for the committee to consider the Air Quality Standards Scotland Amendment Regulations, SSI 2016/376. The details of this negative instrument are to be found in the papers. Can I ask members if they have any comments to make? Mark Roscoe.
Brief comment, not so much about the statutory instrument itself, but more about the context in which it's being introduced. There was a recent High Court ruling, Client Earth versus the Secretary of State for the UK, in which the Scottish Government was cited in that case. And the ruling was, in broad terms, that the UK as a whole state is failing to meet the current air quality standards and regulations that we have. And there are obviously a number of implications from that, and I think it would be useful to get some clarity on what Scottish Government's response is to that ruling and the compliance that we have with existing air quality standards. And of course, you know, that has an implication in terms of adopting more stringent ones as well.
Dave,
point with that case. I mean, I think it would be useful to see whether we could bring forward, the government could bring forward the low emission zone policy suggestion, which has obviously been brought into parts of London, for example, where the money then is apothecated back to helping local authorities. There is plans for that, but that, the two are related. Clearly, if you had low emission zones, you might then comply with the court case.
Okay, two valid points, but not directly related to the SSI. Has anybody else got comments to make? So, with the proviso that we'll write to the Scottish Government taking up those two perfectly reasonable points, or asking for their views around those, is the committee agreed it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? Agreed? Okay, thank you. Okay, so at its next meeting on the 13th December, the committee will hold its second evidence session from a variety of stakeholders and academics on deer management in Scotland. As agreed earlier, we'll now move into private session, and I ask that the public gallery be cleared as the public part of the meeting is closed. Thank you.